This is 10,000 tiny lenses.
Each of those lenses has very, very small structures, 100 nanometer structures, so millions of structures on each lens that can control light in exactly the way that we'd want to.
This is nothing like the lenses in your camera or your eye, and that's kind of the point. This is a totally new approach to making optics.
Grinding and polishing optics is the way that things have been done dating back to Galileo.
Making lenses is something we've been doing for a long ass time. Like the Middle Ages, longer. So it's a hard reset. 1,000 years in the making. Why do this? You see, this is a metamaterial, and it could completely change how our cars, medical devices, or any other machine sees the world.
You're essentially engineering a material to have a response that you wouldn't otherwise see from a natural material.
What this enables is things that just previously were not possible.
Yeah, think invisibility cloaks and tricorders. Are the possibilities limitless? Stick around to see how metamaterials work and how they could change your life. This is Hard Reset, a series about rebuilding our world from scratch. Inside a typical camera is a bunch of super complicated lenses. They work together to bend light rays and focus them onto the imaging material at the back of the camera. These lenses work because light passes through different materials at different speeds. This is called refraction, and it allows us to bend light in different directions. To change how much a lens will bend a ray of light, you need to make it thicker or curve differently. In a camera, there are usually several lenses stacked in order to allow more control over how the beams of light will pass through. But what if you could make optics that were flat and thinner than a human hair? What if you didn't need all this glass to focus light exactly where you wanted it? That sounds like a Hard Reset video. Man, all that lens stuff was a lot to unpack. I feel real smart now. Hi. Rob? This is Rob Devlin, the co-founder and creator of Metalenses.
So what are we seeing here?
This is one of our mass production wafers that has something like 10,000 of our lenses on it. We print our lenses now the same way that you print computer chips on a wafer.
These lenses are not like the ones you know. They're not shaped like a lens at all. They're flat. If you zoomed in with an electron microscope, you'd see that these lenses look like an elaborate pattern of pillars etched into silicon. These pillars are itty bitty bitty. They're nanometers across, and they correspond to the wavelengths of light that they are trying to control. These tiny structures bounce and direct wavelengths of light into exactly where you want them. This is where they're different from the glass or plastic lenses we know. If we want to change the way light is bent as it passes through this material, we don't need to add more material for it to pass through. We just need to change the structure on the surface, and then you can direct that light in any direction you want. This lets you do all the things a glass lens would do and a lot more, without needing to make a big, chonky glass lens. This is Adam Ehrlich.
And my hair looks okay?
His hair looks great. And he also gets really excited about optics.
Our optics get me excited because we're beginning to make instruments the size of a few millimeters, and that opens up new ways of seeing the world. A conventional optic is dependent upon the curvature of the glass to be able to bend the light. In the case of meta optics, it's kind of like sticking your fingers into water, and you have a wave that goes through your fingers. And if you move your fingers exactly right, using constructive and destructive interference, you might be able to create a new wave that goes off in a slightly different direction. In the case of our meta optics, it's just not four fingers. It's millions of little structures on an optic that can control light in exactly the way that we want to.
Thanks, Adam. Millions of little fingers in the water is definitely an image that will haunt me forever. Anyway,
when you make it thin and essentially two-dimensional, you can now mass produce them in the same factories and foundries that have been making the computer chips.
Making lenses in a chip foundry would make them smaller and cheaper, which might not seem like a big deal. But consider the transistor tube. The computers that relied on these vacuum tube transistors were massive, expensive, and frankly, terrible by today's standards.
Back in the days when computers were filled with vacuum tubes, the computer itself was as big as a room. Well, today, we've got computers in our pocket.
Making transistors with semiconductors made them smaller and cheaper, and it also opened the path to exponential growth. Now there are 67 billion transistors in your new MacBook Pro, and we literally have access to more computational power than we know what to do with. Metamaterials mean that our ability to observe and interact with the world around us could see a similar path of exponential growth.
When you take something that hasn't been available to a mass market, you start to put it in millions of people's pockets for the first time. There will be applications that will emerge that we're not even thinking of yet.
So what's it like to use these metamaterials? We visited the Metalenses labs in Boston to see firsthand how these technologies work.
All right, so welcome to Metalenses.
First of all, let me just say, this was the smallest office I could have imagined. I think there was more science per square foot in here than practically any other place in the world. But don't worry, they're moving to a bigger space. Right now, these tiny lenses are being used in lots of mobile devices, mainly as dot projectors for things like depth sensing or face ID. But as the technology has matured, more applications are starting to open up.
If you look at the light that we're taking into a system, conventional optics are mostly collecting the intensity of that light. In light, there's actually a whole bunch of additional information that conventional optics throw out. And one of those examples is polarization.
Lenses made with metamaterials allow us to capture complete polarization information.
We can make a polarization sensor that's really, really small that fits inside of a cell phone, whereas normally a full Stokes polarization sensor would fit on a benchtop. We can shrink that down to a few millimeters on a side. With polarization, you can tell what the object looks like in 3D space. But it's more than just that. Using something like circular polarization, you can actually begin to do some material classification and be able to understand what that material is made of.
That's handy for things like identity verification.
So those are artificial faces. The reasons we're developing that is because it can differentiate between this artificial skin and, you know, genuine human skin. You don't want somebody walking into, you know, a bank with a bust of Mark Zuckerberg and, you know, walking out with $1 million. Now, whether or not he has human skin, you know, who can say?
Fake skin. This is phenomenally weird to be holding.
But besides stopping a robot uprising, polarization can also do things like see through glare or haze, or see black ice on a highway, which makes it super valuable for things like automotive sensing.
It's called black ice because when you look at it in intensity, there's no difference between the ice you're looking at and the surface of the road. But with polarization, that smooth surface of the ice all of a sudden jumps out at you with this additional information set. If you take something like a picture of a growth on the skin, often you can't tell whether it's benign or cancerous, but often there's a specific underlying structure that can have a strong polarization signature. So you can now start to take pictures and with that picture be able to tell if a skin growth is cancerous or not.
This is the Star Trek stuff. Basically, because of metamaterials, all these scientific imaging technologies are about to get super small and super cheap. When you can cram LiDAR, polarization cameras, and spectrometers, and sensors that could see in friggin' microwaves into your cell phone, you basically have a tricorder. A tricorder with TikTok on it, which I think is better.
We can end up making other large benchtop instruments and shrinking those down into form factors that are small enough to be able to fit into a cell phone and make them ubiquitous.
The ability of metamaterials to precisely control light or anything else on the electromagnetic spectrum is going to find its way into your phone, your car, your VR headset, and even into your body. But this isn't just going to make smaller cameras that are cheaper. It's going to make sensors that completely change how we see the world. Are we ready for that? So, picture a scenario where the machines that we've made can see the world more clearly than we can. That's not a speculative future. That's what's going to happen. It's already happening.
We're taking something that hasn't been available in mass devices and hasn't even been something that we can replicate from our own human vision system and putting that into millions and billions of devices and giving millions and billions of people access to that for the first time. The devices we're interacting with will now essentially be able to see the world in a way that we can't necessarily. It's actually providing essentially a new view of the world.
If we rebuilt the world without any glass lenses, we'd lose some things. We'd lose the unique characteristics of lenses like the ones we filmed this video with. We'd lose the way anamorphic lenses stretch and distort backgrounds, or the way those fisheye lenses bend space. The imperfections of those lenses are what make them so wonderful. But these new materials will enable us to see things in a way we'd never be able to experience before.
It rethinks what we're able to sense with our devices and how we're able to understand the world around us.
It's hard not to get excited by the thought that we might soon be able to manipulate and capture light with the same level of control we currently have for information in a computer.
In the future, our optics are going to enable things that people hadn't even dreamed of.
Metamaterials create possibilities that start to seem more like magic than just science fiction. They've already created functional invisibility cloaks for some portions of the electromagnetic spectrum. Just not the visible part, yet. These potential technologies are being built right now. Maybe by one of you. Come back next time for another episode of Hard Reset. Subscribe to Freethink to watch our other original series and documentaries about technology and people that are changing our world.